the administration did its best to hide from the American people the scale of the buildup that was taking place on the other side of the world, fearful that the public would not support the more active role advisors had begun to play in combat.
Mr. President, a Republican National Committee publication has said that you have been less than candid with the American people as to how deeply we are involved in Vietnam. Could you throw any more light on that?
We have increased our assistance to the government, its logistics. We have not sent combat troops there, though the training missions that we have there have been instructed, if they are fired upon, would of course fire back to protect themselves, but we have not sent combat troops in the generally understood sense of the word, so that I feel that we are being as frank as we can be. I think what I have said to you is a description of our activity there.
I was a child of the Cold War. When I got off the plane in Saigon in a humid evening in April 1962, I really believed in all the ideology of the Cold War, that if we lost South Vietnam, the rest of Southeast Asia would fall to the communists. There was an international communist conspiracy. We believed fervently in this stuff.
Neil Sheehan was a 25-year-old reporter for United Press International, UPI. He had served 3 years in the Army, in Korea and Japan, before deciding to become a newspaperman. Vietnam was his first full-time overseas assignment, and his only worry, he remembered, was that he would get there too late and miss out on the big story. Sheehan and other reporters rode along as the Arvin mounted a series of helicopter assaults on enemy strongholds in the Mekong Delta and elsewhere, and brought terror to the Viet Cong. American pilots were at the controls.
It was a crusade, and it was thrilling. And you'd climb aboard the helicopters with the Vietnamese soldiers who were being taken out to battle. And they'd take off and they'd contour fly. They'd skim across the rice paddies at about 3 or 4 feet above the paddies, and then pop up over the tree lines that line the field. It was thrilling. I mean, it was absolutely thrilling. And you believed in what was happening. I mean, you had the sense that we're fighting here, and someday we'll win, and this country will be a better country for our coming.
The new M113 armored personnel carriers were capable of churning across rivers and rice paddies and right through the earthen dikes that separated one field from the next. The Viet Cong had nothing with which to stop them.
We were just overwhelming them with force, with firepower, and the firefights would be over in a pretty short time.
Now some people running along the dikes. Actually, the canal is perpendicular to the one you're attacking now. They have on black uniforms. Now estimate approximately 3-0. Do you have inside, over?
That's what was causing us to win, see? We were winning one after the other. And we were not meeting a heck of a lot of resistance.
Captain James Scanlon had been stationed in West Germany and had seen for himself the brutality with which the communist East Germans dealt with anyone who dared try to escape to the West. He was now in the Mekong Delta, an advisor to the 7th Division of the Arvin, and had begun to see evidence of Viet Cong brutality as well.